लाचरण ओम अज्ञानतिमिरांधस्य ज्ञानांजनशलाकया चक्षुरुन्मीलितं येन तस्मै श्रीगुरवे नमः नमः ओम विष्णुपादाय कृष्णपृष्ठाय भूतले श्रीमते भक्तिवेदांत स्वामीनिति नामिने नमस्ते सारस्वते देवे गौरवाणी प्रचारिणे निर्विशेष शून्यवादी पाश्चात्य देश तारिणे जय श्री कृष्ण चैतन्य प्रभु नित्यानंद श्री अद्वैता गदाधर श्रीवासादि गौर भक्तवृंद हरे कृष्णा 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 हरे 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 राम 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 हरे कृष्णा 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 हरे 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 राम 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 हरे 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 कृष्णा 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 हरे 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 राम 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 हरे हरे ओम नमो भगवते वासुदेवाय सो डियर डिवोटीज वी आर रीडिंग फ्रॉम श्रीमद् भागवतम कैंटो 10 चैप्टर 59 एंटाइटल्ड द किलिंग ऑफ द डीमन नरका एंड वी आर गोइंग टू रीड थ्री वर्सेस टुडे वर्सेस 43 44 एंड 45 And that would conclude chapter number 59. So text 43. Griheshu tasam anapai atarka krin nirastasamya tishayesh avasthitah reme ramabhir nijakama sampluto यथे तरोगार्हकमेधिकांश्चरन् Translations and purports by the humble disciples of our beloved, revered founder Acharya, His Divine Grace, Shri Srimad Abhay Charanarvinda Bhaktivedanta Swami Maharaj, Prabhupada. All glories to Srila Prabhupada. Translation. Lord Krishna, performer of inconceivable activities, constantly remained in each of his queen's palaces, which were unequaled and unexcelled by any other residence. There, although fully satisfied within himself, Lord Krishna enjoyed with his pleasing wives, and like an ordinary husband, he carried out his household duties. Krishna consciousness is all about relationships and Krishna is very personal. We see in this verse proof that Krishna is a very personal God. Even though Krishna is everyone's God, at the same time, Krishna always maintains a very personal one-on-one relationship with each and every one of us. That is the beauty of Krishna consciousness. It is not that when is Ekadashi? Ekadashi is tomorrow. The fasting for Ekadashi is tomorrow, Saturday. So it is not that because Krishna is everyone's God, we are just one among many and we are insignificant. All of us have unlimited significance because Krishna loves all of us individually. And here we see the proof. Krishna had 16,108 wives, but he individually maintained a relationship with all of them. He individually associated with all of them. Same thing we see in the Rasa Leela also. There were millions of gopis, and Krishna was individually dancing with all the gopis. Purport. The word atarkakrit is significant here. Tarka means logic or argument, and atarka means that which is beyond logic and beyond argument. Lord Krishna can perform, krit, krit means to perform. Lord Krishna can perform krit, that which is beyond mundane logic and hence inconceivable. Therefore, Krishna is called Achintya, who is inconceivable. Advaitam Achyutam Anadim Anantarupam Adyam Purana Purusham Navayovanamsha. Vedeshu durlabham, adurlabham atma bhakto, govindam adipurusham, tamaham bhajami. And also, yam shama sundaram achintya gunaswarupam, govindam adipurusham, tamaham bhajami. Krishna is achintya. He's inconceivable because he can perform inconceivable activities. Still, Lord Krishna's activities can be appreciated and understood to a significant extent by those who surrender unto Krishna. Now, it cannot be understood how Krishna can expand himself into 16,108 forms, live every day, every night with his 16,108 queens, have 10 sons from each of them, have daughters from each of them, get them married, be the perfect father, perfect husband, perfect householder. And at the same time, when he comes to meet Maharaj Ugrasen in the royal assembly, all those 16,108 Krishnas become one. And then he goes, does his official work, and then when he comes back again, he's 16,108 Krishnas. So this is inconceivable. But these inconceivable activities of Krishna can be understood if we have devotion, if we have bhakti. Therefore, this is the bhakti center of New York. Bhakti means devotion. Through devotion, we can understand Krishna. And in Bhagavad Gita, Krishna says, Bhaktya mam abhijanati yavanyasya asmitatvata. That only by bhakti one can understand me. So Krishna can be understood through surrender and bhakti. This is the secret of bhakti, which means loving devotion to the Supreme Lord Krishna. Then Srila Sridhar Swami comments that Lord Krishna was always at home, except for when he had to go out to do ordinary household duties. And Srila Vishwanath Chakravarti Thakur points out that since in the Vaikuntha planets, Lord Narayan enjoys with only one goddess of fortune, whereas in Dwarka, Krishna enjoys with thousands of queens, Dwarka must be considered superior to Vaikuntha. Variety is the spice of life, they say. And in Dwarka, there is more variety. In this regard, Srila Vishwanath Chakravarti Thakur also quotes the following passage from the Skanda Purana. Shodashaiva sahasrani gopyastatra samagataha hamsa eva matah krishna paramatma janardana tasyeta shaktayo devi shodashaiva prakirtitaha chandrarupi matah krishna कला रूपा स्तुता स्मृता संपूर्ण मंडला तासाम मालिनी शोदशी कला शोदशैव कला यासु गोपी रूपा वरांगणे एकैकशः ता संभिन्ना सहस्रेण पृथक पृथक. एट दैट प्लेस 16,000 गोपीज वर असेंबल्ड विथ कृष्णा, who is considered the supreme, the super soul, the shelter of all living beings. Janardhan means the shelter of all living beings. Paramatma means super soul. These gopis are his renowned 16 potencies, O goddess. Krishna is like the moon The gopis are like its phases, and the full contingent of gopis is like the full sequence of the moon's 16 phases. From no moon, Amavasya to Purnima, full moon, all the 16 phases are the 16 potencies of Krishna. Each of these 16 divisions of gopis, my dear Varangana, is subdivided into 1,000 parts. That's how you get 16,000. So there are 16,000 potencies of Krishna, which are represented by the 16,000 wives in Dwaraka. Srila Vishwanath Chakravarti Thakur further quotes the Kartik Mahatmya section of Sri Padma Puran. Kaishore Gopa Kanyasta Yauvane Raja Kanyaka. Those who were the daughters of the cowherds. Kaishore Gopakanya. Those who were Gopakanya, those who were Vraj Gopis, Vrindavan Gopis in their early youth, Kaishore, Yauvane Raja Kanyaka. When they became youths, they became the royal princesses in their maturity. Srila Vishwanath Chakravarti Thakur adds, therefore, just as Lord of Dwaraka is a plenary expansion of the supremely complete Lord of Vrindavan, our Muralidhar Krishna, so similarly, his principal queens in Dwaraka, like Rukmini, Satyabhama, Jambavati, are full expansions of his supremely complete spiritual potencies, the gopis. In other words, just like Krishna in Vrindavan is the original form of Godhead and he expands as Dwarkadhish Krishna in Dwarka. Similarly, Radharani, Lalita Sakhi, Vishakha Sakhi, they expand as his queens in Dwarka. Radharani expands as Satyabhama. Chandravali expands as Rukmini. Lalita Sakhi expands as Jambavati. Vishakha Sakhi expands as Vrinda, Kalindi. So like that, Yamuna, because Vishakha Sakhi is Yamuna, who in Dwarka is Kalindi. So in this way, different gopis of Vrindavan, they have become the different queens of Krishna in Dwarka. Text 44. Ittham rama patim avapya patim striyasta brahmadayo pinavidu padavim yadiyam bhejur muda viratame dhitayanuraga hasavalokanava sangama jalpalajja. Thus, those women obtained as their husband, the husband of the goddess of fortune. Although even great demigods like Lord Brahma do not know how to approach the Supreme Lord. Brahma Adi Api Navidu. They don't know how to approach Krishna. But these ladies, they have got Ramapati. They have got the Krishna, who is the Ramapati, husband of Radharani, as their husband. Rama is Radharani. With ever increasing pleasure, they experienced loving attraction for Krishna, exchanged smiling glances with Krishna, and reciprocated with Krishna in ever fresh intimacy, replete with joking and feminine shyness. Sangama, jalpa, hasa, avaloka, lajja, and anurag. They had a lot of attraction. Hasa means they were always smiling, cutting jokes with Krishna. Spiritual world is not a dry world where you just sit and you look at the Supreme Lord 24 hours a day. Darshan is open and you are just looking. And Lakshmi Narayan or Sitaram or Radha Krishna are sitting. Or Rukmini Dwarkadish are sitting and you're just watching them. No. Spiritual life, spiritual world is full of variety, filled with interactions, loving exchanges, millions and millions of times more than what we have in New York. It is more abuzz with transcendental sweet activities than Manhattan. That is the spiritual world. It is described here. And there is shyness, there is sweet conversation, there is sweet association. And it is Nava. Nava Sangama. Every interaction is new, my dear friends. My Guru Maharaj, Śrīla Rādhana Swami Maharaj says, Śrīmati Radharani has been cooking for Krishna since time immemorial, and till date, not one dish has been repeated. Navam Navam, everything the spiritual world is ever fresh and new. Gives everything, there's always the surprise element. What will Krishna make today for me? What will Radharani make today for me? Krishna is thinking. She made such a wonderful breakfast. I wish she makes the same breakfast tomorrow. But next day it is completely different and it is even better than the previous day. It just keeps getting better and better. This is the spiritual world. This is the spiritual experience. It's filled with variety. It's ever fresh and new. Never gets boring and dull. And it's filled with all kinds of emotions. Haas, avaloka means looking very lovingly. Navasangama, new, ever fresh types of associations. Jalpa, fresh, different conversations. And lajja, there's also great modesty and shyness among the queens of Krishna. And the last verse, verse number 45. Pratyudgamasana vararhana pada saucha. So there is a diacritic mistake here. There should be akar on that pada. It's not pada, it should be pada. P-A-D-A. Pada. Pratyudgamasana vararhana pada saucha tambula vishramanave janagandha malyaihi kesha prasara shayana snapanopaharyaihi dasi shata apivibhor vidadhusmadasyam. Shri Shukdev Goswami is describing to Maharaj Parikshit that although the Supreme Lord Krishna's queens, the 16,108 queens in 16,108 palaces, not apartments, palaces, not apartments like Manhattan, palaces, single family homes. Each of the queens had hundreds of maid servants. Haribol. And no one was complaining that we are not getting enough time and attention from Krishna. Everybody was comfortable. Everybody was blissful. There were almost a dozen children from each wife. And Krishna was happily enjoying like a family man. His queen, his children from that queen, and there were hundreds of servants who were blissfully serving Krishna and his family because they are in the Dasya Rati. They have love for Krishna in the mood of servant. So, like Hanumanji, he has Dasya Rati for Lord Ram and Sri Sita Devi. Similarly, in Dwarka, each palace had hundreds of servants who were engaged in serving Krishna and Krishna's family. Although Krishna's queens each had hundreds of maid servants, they chose to personally serve Lord Krishna by approaching him humbly, offering him a asana, a seat, worshipping him with excellent paraphernalia. Vara means first class and arhana means to worship. To worship Krishna with first class paraphernalia. If it's a ghee lamp, it's the finest quality cotton wick. Finest quality ghee. The lamps are nicely polished and cleaned every day. Everything is first class. Yesterday morning I was listening to a lecture of Srila Prabhupada, and Srila Prabhupada was saying that our temples, we should keep cleaning them. The temple floors, walls should be like mirrors, spick and span, clean. The more you clean the temples, the more you will clean your heart, Prabhupada was saying. Your heart will become clean. And Prabhupada was very transcendentally proud of his Western disciples. Prabhupada said, when people come to our temples, ISKCON temples, they remark that, oh, Swamiji, your temple is so clean. Prabhupada is saying like this. And Prabhupada said, I feel very happy when they say like this, because our temples must be very clean. We should always keep cleaning. So everything was very clean and first class paraphernalia. Then Pada Shaucha, they would massage his feet, they would bathe his feet. Tambula, they would give him pan to chew, and they would fan him. They would anoint him with fragrant sandalwood paste. They would adorn Krishna personally with flower garlands, malyai. They would dress his hair, kesha, prasara. They would apply nice fragrant oils to Krishna's soft, curly hair. They would give Krishna a different hairstyle, the queens. These are the intimate descriptions of activities of Krishna with his dear devotees. They would arrange his bed, they would arrange for his bathing, they would present him with various gifts. Even though they had so many servants, there were so many dasi. Dasi, shata. There were hundreds of dasis under each queen, but still the queen would do all these services personally. Thus end the purports of the humble servants of His Divine Grace, A.C. Bhaktivedanta Swami Prabhupada, to the 10th canto, 59th chapter of the Śrīmad Bhāgavatam, entitled The Killing of the Demon Naraka. Hare Krishna. Śrīmad Bhāgavatam ki jai. So this is the spiritual world, my dear friends, where there is love for Krishna in such a personal way that even though there are other conveniences, we always do things for Krishna very personally. We do it very personally. Just like a mother. A mother will feed the child personally. A mother will bathe the child personally. Even though there may be servants, we see in the Damodar Leela in Srimad Bhagavatam that Mother Yashoda also had so many servants, but she was personally churning the yogurt to make butter for Krishna. Personally, even though there were so many servants, personally she was doing it. And this is the nature of spiritual love, where you don't outsource. Nowadays, in management, in the corporate America, corporate world, everything is about delegation. You do this, you do that. Managing people, getting reports. Have you done this? Have you done that? What's the update? Delegation and outsourcing. But material life is just the opposite of spiritual life. Yanisha sarvabhutani tasyam jagrati sammami. What is day for the materialists? That is the night for the spiritualists. There is a night life in big cities where people, after their TGIF, thank God it's Friday. And Friday night, it's a night life. They go to restaurants and pubs and they become active. And our devotees are sleeping at that time, when it is 11 o'clock, 12 o'clock at night, because they have to wake up for Mangalarti. They have to wake up for their japa. So what is day for the materialist is the night for the devotee. And what is day for the devotee? 4:30 in the morning, when Radha Muralidhar will have their Mangalarti, it is day for the devotees. Oh, that time the materialists are crashing after a night of alcohol and sense gratification. They crash and then they wake up at 11 o'clock, 12 o'clock, when devotees are offering Rajbhog. Half their day is already over. That's when the day of the materialist starts. So material life and spiritual life are always opposites. In material life, it's all about delegation and outsourcing. Spiritual life is all about doing something personally for Krishna. So our Adi Purush Prabhu, I always Amarendra Prabhu and me have a perpetual debate. Is Adi Purush Prabhu sewing clothes or is he making flower garlands? Is he cooking? We keep wondering what you are doing so personally for Krishna during class. Is it? I say, I think Prabhuji is cutting vegetables. Amarendra Prabhu says, no, he's always making flower garlands. Some we are speculating. So Prabhuji, please reveal the mystery, what you are doing personally for Krishna without outsourcing. Hare Krishna.
I do this to try to stay awake in class. Night shift. And after I distribute Krishna's prasad for the homeless, when people say, when do you sleep? I say, I sleep in class.
That's your humility, Prabhuji. So yes, spiritual life is doing everything for Krishna personally. I remember, I will conclude with this story. Srila Prabhupada, I think it was the LA temple. It was the Vyasa Puja of Srila Prabhupada's spiritual master, His Divine Grace Srila Bhakti Siddhanta Saraswati Thakur Prabhupada. And Srila Prabhupada told Tamal Krishna Goswami Maharaj, His Holiness Tamal Krishna Goswami Maharaj, that we'll have the feast at noon for my Gurudev. And Tamal Krishna Maharaj said, Prabhupada, this is Los Angeles and it's a weekday. And who is going to come for lunch? Instead, let's have it in the evening. I can fill the temple with devotees in the evening. And Prabhupada said, no, the Vyas Puja feast must be served. Exactly at 11:59 a.m., the feast should be on the altar. And around 11 o'clock, Prabhupada called for His Holiness Tamal Krishna Goswami Maharaj and said, how is the preparation for the feast coming along? And Tamal Krishna Maharaj said, let me go check. And he went to the kitchen and not much had happened. So he came and reported to Prabhupada that, Prabhupada, not much has happened yet. I think we should really do it in the evening. That will give us enough time to cook and prepare, and also more people will come. Prabhupada just stopped what he was doing. He got up, he rolled up his sleeves, entered the kitchen, and in less than 1 hour, Srila Prabhupada had made, I don't know the exact number, but I think 12 items Prabhupada had cooked, each item enough to feed 70 devotees. Single-handedly, Srila Prabhupada cooked, and he did not let anyone do anything. Everything he did personally. You give me this, and Prabhupada himself was doing this. Everything he was doing personally. And I was listening to the memories of Srila Prabhupada, and Nar Narayan Prabhu, he remembers. He said, each and every item that Prabhupada had personally cooked for his Gurudev, it was not of this world. It had such a divine, transcendental taste. We had never tasted anything like that before. And he said, Prabhupada came and personally served all of us the feast. And he said, nothing, not a morsel was left. And Nar Narayan Rishi Prabhu says, remembers that everything was so divine that anybody who ate that, Prabhupada said, will go back to Godhead. Because he said, Krishna had personally eaten it. Krishna had personally tasted it. Prabhupada had personally cooked. Prabhupada was 73, 74 years old. What was the need? He had hundreds of disciples there. He could have just told them, okay, whatever, make it. But no, spiritual life is very personal. When Lord Ram was banished for 14 years to the forest, he went and told Lakshman that this is what I have to do now. So you stay here, take care of our parents, and I will go 14 years to the forest. And Lakshman could have said, should I arrange for some personal servant to accompany you in the forest? Ayodhya had so many servants. Or did he say that, well, it's too bad, my dear brother. I guess I'll see you in 14 years. Take care. No. He left everything. He left everything. Nothing else was important. And he went with his Lord. He went with Ram 14 years to serve him. And Mother Sita did the same thing. So this is spiritual life. We do things from the heart personally. It's very personal. And we We offer it with love, and Krishna accepts it with love. One peacock offers its feather to Krishna because Krishna danced with the peacocks. Out of gratitude, the peacocks give feather. Even today, Krishna is holding peacock feather in his turban. One Gajendra, while dying, offers one lotus flower to Krishna, a personal offering. And even today, Lord Narayan, in one of his four hands, always holds that lotus flower that was offered by Gajendra. This is how personal the devotees are, and this is how personal Krishna is. So spiritual life means welcome to the world of personal, loving service. Hare Krishna. So I will stop here, and if there are any comments or questions, we can take. Hare Krishna. Srila Prabhupada ki jai.
Wonderful class, Ādi Gadādhara Prabhu. A question. Srila Prabhupada says in his purports that Krishna consciousness is a gradual process. How can one drop everything and surrender to Krishna, go into the forest of Vrindavan, drop everything, and do it gradually? How does that work?
Like we always say, Krishna consciousness is not a 100-meter sprint. It is a lifelong marathon. So whatever we do, it has to be done in a sustainable way. If we just drop everything and we run to Vrindavan, it is like darting a 100-meter sprint. After that, we'll be exhausted and we'll collapse. It will not be sustainable. So Krishna consciousness, like Srila Prabhupada said, is a gradual process. Even Srila Rupa Goswami describes Adav Shraddha Tatha Sadhu Sangata Bhajana Kriya. He describes it's a gradual process. First, you come with a little faith. With that faith, you associate with the devotees, Sadhu Sangha. Adav Shraddha. Shraddha is faith, then Sadhu Sangha. Then because of Sadhu Sangha, by associating with devotees, your Bhajana Kriya starts. Your practice of devotional service starts. You start chanting. You start attending the morning Śrīmad Bhāgavatam class every day. So that's how your Bhajana Kriya starts. And because of this Bhajana Kriya, then there is Anartha Nivritti. The vices in the heart slowly go away. Lust, anger, greed, envy, pride, false ego. These things slowly, slowly, they go away. That is called Anartha Nivritti. Then our faith becomes very strong. It is called Nishtha. Then we get some taste in Krishna consciousness. That is called Ruchi. Then we become very strongly attached to Krishna. It becomes Asakti. Then we start experiencing some spiritual emotions. It's called Bhava. And then we get actual love, Prem. So, 9 stages, and Srila Rupa Goswami says they are kramena. Kramena means they are step by step, gradual progression. So therefore, Krishna consciousness has to be done in a progressive way, and we have to evaluate ourselves and assessing ourselves whether we are making advancement or not. We have to compare ourselves with ourselves, not with others, with ourselves. What was I doing last year? Had I read Srimad Bhagavatam? How many cantos I had read? How many rounds I was chanting? Was I having these bad habits? How much social media I was wasting my time? How much news? How much Netflix or whatever I was watching? So we have to compare. Okay, now I have reduced it to this much. That means I'm making progress. Now I do it only once a week. I'm making progress. So we have to compare with ourselves and make sure we have to do a self-assessment. Make sure that we are headed in the right direction and not that we are gliding down spiritually. We should be climbing up. And that's a matter of self-assessment. And slowly, slowly, if through self-assessment, through practice, we are making more and more and more and more advancement, then a time will come when we are simply hearing and chanting all day long, and we are completely blissful. And there are so many devotees who are like that. Our Barsana Maharaj is there in New Vrindavan. He is so absorbed in Vrindavan. So absorbed in Vrindavan. Very simple. Not many devotees know about him. His Holiness Barsana Swami Maharaj in New Vrindavan. For years he has been serving. He considers New Vrindavan to be non-different from Vrindavan because Prabhupada said so. Such faith. Simple, innocent faith. And look at his dedication all his life. Look at Jananivas Prabhu in Sri Mayapur Dham. Prabhupada said, you stay and serve Radha Madhav. A first-class pujari is one who never leaves. And he never left. It's been more than 50 years. A first-class pujari. And there are so many examples of devotees of steady service. So it's a gradual process. And if we keep making spiritual progress through self-assessment and self-critique, then we will reach a point where we become like these devotees, where now we can do our service blissfully, happily, hearing, chanting. So does that make sense, Prabhuji?
Yes, perfect. It's very encouraging and inspiring to hear that.
Hare Krishna. Should we chat box?
Yeah, there's something in the chat from Neha, I believe.
Okay, one second. Okay, Neha Sarkar, question. I need to hear the meaning of enjoys with the 16,108 queens to hammer into my mind, because in this world, the particular word enjoys has been perverted so much, no matter how much I try to teach my mind differently. Hare Krishna. Well, we are not the enjoyers. So when we apply the word enjoy to ourselves, that is a perversion. And Krishna is the enjoyer. By definition, Ram or Krishna, the name itself means one who is all attractive and one who is a supreme enjoyer. Ramante iti Ram. One who enjoys is Ram. Even in today's verses, the word Reme came. Reme means enjoying. Krishna was enjoying. Reme. So Ram, Reme. Ram is the one who enjoys. And if we are connected with Krishna, who is the source of all enjoyment, then we also enjoy it. We also enjoy. Because in Bhagavad Gita, Krishna says that machitta maggata prana bodhayanta parasparam kathayantas chamam nityam tushanti cha ramanti cha. They are the four most important verses of Bhagavad Gita. 10th chapter, 8, 9, 10, and 11. This is called Chatushloki Bhagavad Gita. The four verses which describe the message of Bhagavad Gita in a nutshell. So the first verse begins like this. Second verse is like this. That Tushanti cha ramanti cha. That my devotees also ramanti. They also enjoy. Why? Because machitta madgata prana. Because they are completely conscious of me, completely absorbed in discussing about me. So Krishna is the enjoyer. And when we say Krishna enjoys, it is not an exploitative enjoyment. In this material world, when we say I enjoy, it means I am getting some sense gratification from you. And if the other person also experiences some tangible sense gratification, then, oh, let's get married. Let's be together. Let's move in together. Let me propose. Why? Because you make me happy. You make me enjoy. And it just so happens that I also make you enjoy. You like me and I like you. And it's a you scratch my back, I scratch my back type of situation. So we are together. And people call it love. But actually, it is because you are getting enjoyment from that person. That person somehow suits your nature and makes you happy. So you are together. If that same person starts abusing, starts insulting, stops reciprocating with your love, then immediately the relationship is terminated. It is broken. There is a divorce. This is the nature of this world. It's just how it is. Krishna is not that Lord. Krishna is that loving Lord who loves us even though for lifetimes we have neglected him. Even though we have said so many times in our this life and previous lifetimes, I don't believe in God. Essentially, we are telling Krishna with the ability that he has given us that I don't believe in you. I don't think you exist. We have not reciprocated with Krishna for so many lifetimes. Yet, Krishna is still showing himself to us in his most attractive form of Radha Muralidhar. Still, he is giving himself to us in the form of Śrīmad Bhāgavatam. still he is making himself accessible to us through the association of his devotees. How merciful can Krishna be? So Krishna is not an exploitative enjoyer. Krishna enjoys by tushyanti cha ramanti cha, by giving us enjoyment. That is Krishna's enjoyment. Krishna's enjoyment is to give pleasure to the devotees. Otherwise, in this verse that we read, Krishna is described as Atmaram. Even though he's Atmaram, still he's enjoying with the queens. Why? So that the queens will enjoy. How does Narsimharti begin? Every day we see sing Narsimharti. The proof is there in Narsimharti. Namaste Narasimhaya Prahalad Ahalada Daine. Daine means to give. Ahalad means happiness, pleasure, joy. Who is Narsimhadev? Namaste Narsimhaya. I offer my obeisance to Narsimhadev. Who? Prahalad Ahalada Daine. Who is the giver of pleasure to Prahalad? So what is Narsimhadev's identity? One who gives pleasure to Prahalad Maharaj. See how sweet our Lord is. He keeps his identity as, I am one who gives pleasure to my devotees. So that is Krishna's enjoyment. Krishna's enjoyment is to give enjoyment to us. Otherwise, Krishna doesn't need any of us. He is self-sufficient. He is completely independent and self-sufficient. But when he sees that we love him, we have devotion for him, then Krishna wants to reciprocate. Ye yatha mam prapadyante tam satheva bhajamyam. And he makes his greatest pleasure in accepting our love and giving his unlimited, unconditional love back to us. So, Neha Mataji, I hope this is okay. Then we can go on.
There's two more in the chat. One from Jeffrey Eckler, one from Ananda Manjari. Beautiful questions.
Okay. Question from Jeffrey. Why such emphasis on material wealth when in association with Krishna? So Krishna's leela, Krishna's pastimes are of two types, Aishwaryamaya and Madhuryamaya. Dwarka is Aishwaryamaya and Vrindavan is Madhuryamaya. Aishwaryamaya means it's filled with opulence. Filled with opulence. So when we have money in this world, this money actually exists because there is money in the spiritual world. This comforts, luxuries, material wealth exists because there is spiritual wealth. And the abode of real spiritual wealth is Vaikuntha and Dwarka. Whereas the intimacy, the sweetness of relationships, that abode is Vrindavan. So because Dwarka is the original abode of wealth, there is so much emphasis on wealth. That the bedsteads are made of gold, the tables are made of ivory, the pillars were bedecked with beautiful gems, the fan with which Krishna was being fanned, the handle was studded with diamonds. Because that is the original abode of wealth. And material wealth exists because in the spiritual world, spiritual wealth exists. So why emphasis on wealth? Because that's the source of all wealth. It's coming from there. So like that. So we may say, why Krishna has two hands? No. Because Krishna has two hands, we have two hands. Because man is made in the mirror, in the image of God, as Bible teaches us. So because there is spiritual wealth there, there is material wealth here in this material world. There are millionaires because Krishna is the original wealthy person. And last question. Question two from
why is Jeffrey Eckler wearing glasses? Because Krishna is wearing glasses.
Sorry, I didn't get that right.
The question is, why is Jeffrey Eckler wearing glasses? That's because Krishna is wearing glasses.
Yes. And that is the glasses of love. Premanjana Churita Bhakti. I am curious to know what is the relationship of Lalita and Vishakha with Srimati Radharani while they are taking forms of Krishna's many queens in Dwarka. Do they shift their service of being primary servant Shamsundar? How do they continue religion? Yes. So the relationship, the bhav is different. Like we discussed, in Vrindavan, it is the abode of sweetness. And Dwarka, it's the abode of awe and reverence. So they come because Krishna cannot live without Lalita, Vishakha, Radharani. So Radharani, Lalita, Sakhi, Vishakha, Sakhi, they all come in Dwarka to continue their service to Krishna, but in a different mood. So Dwarka, the mood is different, but because Krishna cannot live without his Brijvasi associates, so they come, but in a different mood, and they adopt the mood of the dham. The mood of Dwarka dham is service with awe and reverence and opulence. And that's the mood they take. So they're serving Krishna in a different way. But service to Krishna continues. It's not that if Krishna goes to Dwarka, Radharani, Lalita, Vishakha, their service will stop. No, bhakti is apratihata. It is continuous. It never breaks. So therefore, They will come to Dwarka in a different form and they will continue serving Krishna in the mood of that particular dham, like that. I hope that makes sense.
Actually, I want to make a clarification. So my question was specific related to Lalita and Vishaka's service towards Srimati Radharani as they are taking their new forms in Dwarka. Can you speak about that?
So this is a little complex because in Vrindavan, Srimati Radharani is supreme because it's the Madhurya Dham. It is the abode of sweetness and Srimati Radharani's sweetness reigns supreme in Vrindavan and Lalita and Vishakha are subservient to Radharani. They assist Radharani in her pastimes with Krishna. Only occasionally they will directly have interactions with Krishna. But when you come to Dwarka, the mood is different. In Dwarka, it's the Aishwarya Dham. So Chandravali becomes supreme. She becomes Rukmini, who is the main queen of Krishna. And Radharani, who is Satyabhama, and Lalita and Vishakha Sakis, Jambavati, and Kalindi, they become co-wives. So in the Aishwarya mood of Dwarka, they also have their own direct interaction with Krishna, direct children from Krishna, a palace where they live with Krishna. So this is not similar to the mood of Vrindavan at all. So it is not that in Dwarka, they will be subservient to Satyabhama. No, they are co-wives. So that equation changes in Dwarka because the mood of the dham is different. So they don't have the mood of being subservient to Radharani. They become co-wives. They become equals there in Dwarka. So it's a different mood. But our Vrindavan mood is the best, where Srimati Radharani is the Swamini and everyone else is blissfully serving Radharani directly. Is that okay, Ananda Puri Mataji?
Yeah, I have like one kind of curiosity. Okay, maybe I'll save it for later. Thank you so much.
Oh, okay. Yeah.
Jai Shri Shri Radha Muladhara, Shri Guru Chandra Ki Jai, Shri Ādi Gadādhara Prabhu Kaviraja Ki Jai. Thank you, Prabhu. You handle those questions like a boss. Not like a boss, like a devotee, like a servant of Krishna. We don't say like a boss in bhakti, right? We say like a devotee. Thank you, Prabhu. Thank you. Any final instructions for us? Yeah, by the way, there's a question. Maybe you could answer that if you have time, Ādi Gadādhara Prabhu. Siham said, find that understanding Krishna's intimate relationships with gopis using my material mind gets me really confused. To be on the safe side, don't ask questions on this topic. Yeah, Siham doesn't ask questions, but we're gonna ask questions. We have nothing to lose. Yeah, so how do we not get confused when we kind of apply our material standards to what Krishna does intimately with his devotees?
Yes, Hare Krishna. So if we apply our material conditionings or our material experiences to the experiences that Krishna has with the gopis, which are described in Srimad Bhagavatam, then we will get confused because we are superimposing our material conceptions on something that is transcendental, something that is spiritual. It's in a different dimension. So it's like saying why an aeroplane that is flying from JFK airport not stopping at the stop signs on the road. Because we are used to driving on the road, our little Toyota Prius, which has to stop at every traffic light. If we apply the same rule on the Airbus that is flying 25,000-30,000 feet in the sky, then that logic won't work. So Krishna is like that. Krishna is way above us. And the rules of the morals, ethical rules that are meant for our purification don't apply to the all pure Lord. These rules apply to us so we can attain the Supreme Lord. So yes, if we look at Krishna through material eyes, then we will be bewildered. We will be confused. That's why Shukdev Goswami has described the 9 cantos. That first we understand who is Krishna. First we understand how Krishna's expansion of the expansion of the expansion is Mahavishnu, who creates this material world. And how then morals and ethics are given by Manu Maharaj in Manu Samhita. And who is Manu? He is created by Brahmaji. He's Brahmaji's son, Swayambhuva Manu. And Brahmaji is created by Garbhodakshaya Vishnu. And Garbhodakshaya Vishnu comes from Karnodakshaya Vishnu. Karnodakshaya Vishnu comes from Chaturvyoha. Chaturvyoha comes from Mula Sankarshan. Mula Sankarshan comes from Lord Balaram. Lord Balaram comes from Krishna. Sarva Avatari Krishna, Swayam Bhagavan. Tahara Dvitiya Deha Shri Balaram. When we understand it, oh, wow, this is Krishna. And this is that Krishna who is enjoying Rasleela. He is not an ordinary person. He is not an ordinary person. So first we have to understand who is Krishna. We have to understand Krishna's merciful nature. We have to understand the different rasas that devotees have with Krishna. We have to understand our position, how we are stuck in this material world. Then when we see Krishna's pastime through Shastra Chakshu, through eyes given by scriptures, not eyes given by our material conditionings, but eyes given by scripture, Shastra Chakshu. Chakshu means eyes, Shastra means the holy scriptures. When we see Krishna through Shastra Chakshu, eyes given by the scriptures, then we can see Krishna as it is. And that's the whole process of sadhana. That's why we are chanting. That's why we are studying Srimad Bhagavatam systematically, Bhagavad Gita, Chaitanya Charitamrita. That's why we are doing Thursday night kirtans, so that our heart becomes purified. Cheto Darpana Marjanam, Shri Krishna Sankirtanam. And then one day we will be able to understand. So we should ask about Krishna's intimate dealings with the gopis, but very confidentially to some devotee who we trust, to some devotee who we are convinced actually understands this. And then we should confidentially ask. Then our doubts will be clarified slowly. So that is my take on that. Is that okay, Anand Bihari Prabhu?
That's okay with me, yes. Siham, you still here? Is that okay?
Good. Yeah, this is okay. Maybe my question is really stemming from the environment I was in when I first encountered Krishna consciousness. I was told, like, stay away from, you know, confidential, you know, topics. And you, Prabhu, you just explained it really perfectly when you said you have to really address it with
you know, pure devotees in a confidential manner, because I feel these are not mundane topics. And just not to confuse myself or really to commit offenses, I just don't address it like, you know, and that just me, not to criticize others who are asking questions. By all means, this conversation has been really helpful to me. I was just talking about my own feeling and my own reaction to the topic. But this has been really helpful. Thank you so much.
Hare Krishna. I pray that one day you become a gopi with Radha and Krishna. Hare Krishna.
Yeah. You have time to listen to what Dima has to say? He has his hand up.
Yes.
Dima Prabhu is beating his mind up with a broom.
He's holding a gada.
Hare Bhav Prabhu, what a wonderful, sweet subject. I can speak as a gopi because I have a broom in my hand, so I'm doing the work here and I'm pretending. Anyways, what I'd like to say is I actually brought up the subject matter as a bhakta with Ranganath Maharaj back in early 1982. Can you hear me okay, by the way?
Yeah, don't walk too far away from me.
Okay. Okay. So, long story short, he said, well, we offer food to Krishna and Krishna eats it. And he goes, and then he described, he goes, in the material body, we have to take it in. The saliva breaks down. We masticate it with our teeth. We swallow it. It goes into our esophagus. He explained the whole physical, material way in which we take food in, digest it, use it for our health. And then, of course, the other thing happens is we evacuate it. And he says, that's eating in the material world. So similarly, Krishna does not do that. Krishna simply sees the food and he feels the rasa of the love that in the offering, the ideal of the care that came from the heart of the bhakta who would cook the food in the preparation, the carefulness, and then the love. That's what Krishna is consuming. He's consuming the devotion. That's his enjoyment. That's his ras, and that's the devotee's offering. So similarly, he said, in the ideal of Madhura ras, it's not about, we don't understand it because we are confusing our material bodies, which is actually just a yantra, just a machine. And at that time, I was studying nutrition, and he had noticed that I had a physiology book which sold the sort of like the atlas of the human body from the muscles to the veins to the internal organs and stuff. And he goes, this is not, I was a bhakta at the time, so I needed to understand, this is not Krishna. And the relationship that Krishna has with the devotee is on the ideal platform. It is the sentiment, the ras, the feeling, and the love that he enjoys. So extrapolating, I didn't have to go too far to extrapolate that the intimate pastimes that he shares with the gopis is of the ideal platform. It is of a world. It is of a world of surrender, intimacy, abandonment, and selflessness. Not a world of physical interaction. And so, you know, not that I'm understanding what's going on, but it helped me to understand the dichotomy between what we feel is intimacy on that level of male and female and the intimacy that is shared between the lover, the gopis, and the beloved, which would be Krishna. Anyways, I just thought I'd share that because I always remembered that time that Radhanath Maharaj sat me down and explained that confusing concept for me. Thank you. Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna. Thank you, Bhima Prabhu. Very nice analogy of eating, digestion, and Krishna accepting in a very spiritual way. Gross and spiritual.
Radhanath Swami Maharaj's grace is glowing through Bhima Prabhu and Ādi Gadādhara Prabhu. They're both disciples of Radhanath Swami. Thank you, dear Prabhus, for channeling Maharaj's Shakti and his deep devotion. Thank you. Okay. Final instructions, Ādi Gadādhara Prabhu. One, two lines, and then we'll go off to our day.
Read the words of Srila Prabhupada. Chant Hare Krishna and be happy.
Right. Chant and be great. Okay. This was it. Thank you very much, everybody. Nice seeing you. Karen, where are you? Are you in Switzerland? Feeding ducks with Prashanam?
Except for me, I'm not in Switzerland. I'm still in New Hampshire.
Right. Yeah. I was like, yeah, it doesn't look like Switzerland. There's no ducks.
Yeah. Yep. But I'm going back tomorrow.
Cool.
Great. Yeah.
Yeah, when you get on the plane, think of that analogy that Ādi Gadādhara Prabhu shared.
Okay.
Stop the traffic light.
Okay.
Hare Krishna. Thank you, Ādi Gadādhara Prabhu. Wonderful class again. Hare Krishna, Hare Ram. Nice seeing everybody. We love you. We need you. Come again tomorrow. Tomorrow is the Kadashi, right? Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna.